At this point, I was lying in something like a morgue. Then I saw a piece of paper with a twine attached to my right toe. It said, Josef Atzmüller died on the 20th of December at 8 p.m.
Did you see your body from above or rather from your body's perspective?
I saw it from the body itself. Although one can't really say that either because I wasn't able to open my eyes. It was the same when I perceived some visitors while being seemingly unconscious to them. Similarly, I was able to perceive everything in that moment.
So you saw the label on your toe from the outside?
Yes, it was from the outside actually, putting it precisely.
I experienced it in a way that it was much bigger than my body, and that I was suddenly able to perceive the whole situation from the outside. Only then I was able to see the extent of the blood loss, as well as my body, who was laying there on the edge of death. I saw the paramedics, the emergency doctor, and also the confusion and anxiety. I, on the other hand, felt calmness and peace. Everything was still. I woke up in the hospital, but not physically. I was floating above my body. I saw myself laying there with the doctors around me who were doing something. I didn't care much. The next memory of mine is that I've seen my mother by my bed, who aged by years. She cried for me and kept saying, Krista, you cannot go. Stay with me.
Seeing without eyes. Perceiving without sensory organs. Consciousness without body. That which is obvious to most people who've had near-death experiences is quite unimaginable for science-oriented people. Consciousness originates from the brain. It shows itself in the brainwaves, and only there. And yet, some extraordinary perceptual phenomena call this materialistic worldview into question. For instance, the case of this blind man who can read the newspaper as soon as he switches to another form of perception. Up there is a beech forest, I'd say. Here is, I think, a dam wall. From the reservoir to the amusement park. Seeing without eyes. Experiences at the limit of sensual perception that lead right into the mysterious realm of human consciousness. Josef Johann Atzmüller experienced a battle for his life in his youth, which lasted several days and was due to an undetected ruptured appendix. Once it became clear the doctors couldn't do anything for him, his parents came to the hospital bed in order to say goodbye to him. They found him unconscious with closed eyes. Yet, at the same time, he was able to perceive everything. My father wore a brand new suit. My mother looked very well dressed too, I'd say. My mother came up to me, greeted me, and kissed me on the cheek. My father stayed at the end of the bed. I thought, hello, what's going on? Why isn't he coming? I asked him that, but he was showing no reaction at all. Suddenly, I understood that I was unconscious for my parents, whilst I was actually able to perceive them, hear them.
So from your parents' point of view, you were unresponsive?
From my parents' point of view, I was unresponsive, yes. My father's brother, Uncle Emmerich, was involved in the construction of the A1 highway. He said during his visit that they were building a part of it near Melk. He was one of the visitors. Years later, I reminded him of what he talked about back then. He couldn't believe it. No one knows that. I said, yes, I do. You said it during a visit at the hospital. For me, this was a situation where I was able to prove that I could hear them. Josef Atzmüller eventually became healthy again, without any medical explanations. But out-of-body experiences occur quite often when being near death. They are an especially interesting phenomenon for the scientific study of death, namely thanatology. An impressive example is Howard Storm, who became famous due to his negative near-death experience. His case, for instance, was as follows. He went out of body, which had an incredible intensity. He was suffering lots of pain. Previously, he had experienced a stomach perforation, which was very critical. So he left his body and was even able to describe the smell. It was the smell of urine, hospital and linoleum floor. Above all, he got very irritated as soon as he saw himself, comatose, lying in bed. And he even thought, did they trick me? Maybe they made a wax figure. Seeing yourself from above. People who've had near-death experiences often report that they have watched the physical event from a bird's eye view. But how would that be possible? We assume that a functioning visual system is required in order for our brain to receive and process external impressions. Is it possible that visual perception can occur in another way? We visit Harald Frase in Karlsruhe. He is blind, but due to a special technique, he is apparently able to turn on a different way of seeing. My name is Harald Frase. I've been legally blind since 2007. Here in Germany, legally blind means that one's better eye has no more than 2% eyesight. I can only perceive light and dark and a shadow which is 20 to 30 centimeters away, if something comes around. This disease is called Morbus Ealis, and I've been affected by it since 1983. It appeared every now and then and involved some surgery. Later, it was discovered through magnetic resonance imaging that the visual nerves are affected as well, which led to blindness. Since April 2011, I've been a member of the registered association called General Assistance for the Blind and Visually Impaired, where I'm participating in a voluntary capacity as a regional manager, as well as a representative in the National Association. That means we're assisting people who are affected. My job, which I quite enjoy, is to show them ways of how life simply continues. Everyone who finds out that their eyesight is going kind of falls into a deep hole, some more and some less than others. In my experience, gained over the years, life does indeed go on, and I'm demonstrating that. I have various hobbies, like cooking and baking, for example, and many people wonder how I'm able to do it. Well, what's learned once cannot get lost. One can learn to achieve the desired outcome through certain tricks or tactics, and I'm always willing to show people how it can be done. Tricks and tactics are on the one side of the spectrum. But Harald Frase also talks about a technique called seeing without eyes, which apparently even enables him to read. We ask him for evidence.
Are you ready?
I'll try it.
I'm going to show you something, and you can simply tell me what you can see and read there.
We bought the daily newspaper right before filming. Well, I'm going to activate it now in order to recognize something. That can take a few moments. Okay. At the top it says journey, and then in the magical realm of beach. The Kälteswald National Park holds one of the last big stocks in Germany. Then we have photos here. Up there is a beech forest, I'd say. Here is, I think, a dam wall. From the reservoir to the amusement park. The dam wall of Lake Eder, which was damaged during World War II. The next photo shows some old, half-timbered buildings. It's not a fluent reading. Harald Frase is looking for orientation aids to text comprehension. But the fact that he is able to read the text overall, even though he's seeing this newspaper for the first time, is quite obvious. There is restoration. Then we have information at the bottom. The size of the writing is pretty small for me. It should be a bit bigger. The headlines are fine. This size works pretty well, and this one works too. Step by step to the Elbe Spring, with the Czech train to castles and mountains. And then we have Silesia, where the sky kisses the earth. Harald Frase explains that if he really focuses, then he is able to read even small fonts. So we show him a chess puzzle. That is really tiny. I don't know how many pixels there are.
Try it.
I'll try. Well, this is about a chess problem. I do recognize the chess pieces. Here we have the knights, black and white ones. Here it says black has the move. And then it starts. It gets blurry again. Well, the way I would play if black has the move is like this, since the queen here moves towards the knight. Harald Frase prefers to make do with his own experience here. Still, a practically completely blind person can extract information from a newspaper. That is quite a phenomenon. I don't have to prove anything to anyone. But what's important to me is that I was able to read back then, so one day it'll be possible again. That was it for the chess problem. During his search for ways to participate in as many previous activities as possible as a blind person, Harald Frase got a phone call, which he still remembers to this day.
Evelyn hatte mich angerufen. Ja, ich bin die Evelyn Oli und
Evelyn called me and said, I am Evelyn Oli and I'm teaching people to see without eyes. Oh, what's that? Seeing without eyes sounds interesting. I am very open-minded, but I really couldn't imagine what that was. In our conversation, I asked her to give me some time to think it over and some sources in order to inform myself about it. That took around 1.5 months, and then I called her back, and we made an appointment for an event, since I host monthly events in Karlsruhe, named Open Meets, where I invite various people like doctors or naturopaths, or even people like Evelyn, who represent something completely different. The purpose of it is to inform people about the opportunities that they have in order to still make something meaningful or useful out of their affected life.
Einfach aus ihrem betroffenen Leben wirklich etwas Sinnvolles oder was Nützliches wieder zu erreichen.
Then I obviously asked, how does it go? Theory is one side of the story, but practice is another. That's how I participated in a seminar for the first time. The first seminar was a crucial experience for me, which moved me a lot.
Wo ich tatsächlich halt gerührt war.
For a few milliseconds, I'm not quite sure how long it was, but for a very brief moment, I was able to see everything that was on the table, crystal clear. Then everything blacked out again. At the first seminar, I didn't perceive colors, but gray shades. There is a range of colors and a range of grays. I can tell a little bit what kind of grey shade belongs to which colour hue. Therefore, I acted on it and said, okay, something must happen in the brain. I couldn't explain it, even though I asked questions over and over again. I had several conversations with Axel Kimmel as well, but he just said that I shouldn't ask too much. Well, I am a person who questions a lot. Basically, the result of the first seminar was that I was able to tell the right colors, even though I perceived them as gray shades. After a while, in February or March 2016, I attended the second seminar. That was when I was indeed able to perceive colors and even objects. For me personally, that is something very beautiful, since I can recognize things that are important to me.
You play pool?
That's just for the fun of it. I used to play pool for fun quite a lot back in the days. I just have to activate it whenever I want to hit the ball. Now, we would like to see that too. It was always important to me to view this seeing without eyes, as I've accepted it to this day, as a tool. It's a tool just like other electronic devices are, and there are many of them for blind people. I'm now able to activate it, but if I use it for too long, meaning over 15 minutes, then I get a headache, even though I cannot tell why. That's just the way it is, and so I stop it. But what I do know is that I am able to activate it now. It took me a while to do so, not just one or two visits. I trained a lot at home as well. Moreover, it is also very important to get used to perceiving things again as a visually impaired person. Apparently, it is much easier for kids to get along with the idea of being able to see without eyes. Often, they learn the technique surprisingly fast.
Foam material, and in the front we have plastic again.
Evelyn Oli, who leads the seminars for seeing without eyes, is showing the special opaque masks to the mothers. The kids will use them in order to show us what they've learned. But first, the adults are allowed to convince themselves that these masks are indeed opaque.
Yes, they are opaque. I cannot see anything. It's dark. Everything around me is black.
Now, we're allowed to assign all kinds of tasks to the kids. Let's start with ball exercises. Quite impressive, yes, but not really convincing yet. With a little practice, one's sense of hearing could maybe lead to such reactions. So we picked a more difficult task for the two. They have to sort these cups by color. Thank you. off. Lastly, Luan proves to us that even riding a bike is no problem while having the eye mask on. In certain situations, like baking or cooking, it is very useful to not be dependent on the sense of smell or the sense of touch, only so you're able to look at some products to see if they are still fresh. Or whenever I repair something at someone else's house, which I do every now and then, I do like to help people, and it actually became my goal in life, helping other people. I'm being asked a lot whether I can do this or that, and in those cases it is very useful to be able to activate something and to actually look at it quickly. What does it look like? What's broken?
Und das ist für mich halt etwas, wo ich sagen kann, okay.
That's something that made me realize that I am actually not as dependent on others anymore to tell me how it looks. I can perceive things myself again. It's another way of perception, but I do believe that it is the same surrounding or so-called reality as we usually perceive, if not a little more intense regarding the colors. During our researches, we did not find any reasons for the assumption that seeing without eyes might be a scam. But if visual perception is indeed possible without eyes and visual nerves, then how does it work? And what are the limits?
So, können wir einen Test machen?
Can we make a test? I have a card deck here, which I'm going to shuffle. I don't know myself which one it will be. I'm picking the first one. Mm-hmm. And I'm asking you to tell me what it is.
Definitely red. It should be the Ace of Diamonds.
Let's try not to turn the card around and see whether that's possible too.
That would be intuition now.
That doesn't matter.
We have... Die nächste Karte.
It's definitely a red one, hearts. And it is a number, not an image. It's a number, but I'm tending to 9.
Almost.
When it comes to the training, you not only learn to see without eyes, but also to use your intuition. Practice intuition. And this game is kind of part of it. The game is simply part of it. Sometimes it does work if they're turned around, but the rate is not 100% yet. It was fascinating. We had a 12-year-old boy who was born blind. He obviously knew the Braille alphabet. His father also did pottery and made letters out of clay in order for him to grasp them. Thus, he could kind of tell how the letters were formed and assign them. So, we gave him word stencils. He recognized many of the letters, and some others he then learned. Within 5 days, he was able to read big fonts, recognize them visually. The fascinating part was when we asked him to read license plates by walking up to random cars. Interestingly, he began to read the first 2 letters of the license plate. He knew that. Then 2 more letters followed, which he also knew. And then he told us that there were 2 semicircles and one was on top of the other. He said it could be a number, but he doesn't know which one. It was the number 3, of course. I thought it was very fascinating that this young man knew the Braille alphabet, was able to calculate, knew numbers, but didn't know how they visually looked. We were all excited about it. He then told us about a cross and a slash that connects the cross, which was the number 4. It was obvious to us, but he didn't know that. It was quite interesting.
What is your explanation for these phenomena? How does all of this work?
My explanation is that it has to be a holistic perception. There are lots and lots of theories on how it exactly works. I stopped clinging onto one theory because I'm limiting myself by doing so. I learned that many times in my own seminars. We hosted a seminar. I had a theory, and at one point a participant came up to me and proved to me the exact opposite. At one point, I stopped coming up with theories. I am rather trying to expand what I grasp as much as possible. Regarding seeing without eyes, we discovered that it is just as easily possible to perceive the color if it is being held behind the head, or that it is just as easily possible if the color is above the head. We tried it over and over again, and it works as soon as people are ready and willing to do something new. Then it is possible. I experienced that one can hear colors, that one can feel colors. All these things do work if one is willing to get involved in it. If I, as a human being, sharpen my senses, or I would rather say, use them with all of their possibilities that they have, which are grandiose, then everything is possible. How all of it works in the end? Well, one can also look through walls and look into different rooms with this technique. That would mean it has to be something out of body, in my opinion.
Can you look through walls?
Well, this is my most recent experience. I practiced it with my daughter a couple of times, but she stopped ever since she looked through one door and saw me. That was the breakpoint for her, and she did very little training afterwards. I trained just recently again because I thought, well, it's actually exciting to be able to see further through different things. My experience was as follows. I had some thick black cardboard and I practiced looking through it. I reached my own limits again once I was able to see through it. I recognized the patterns behind it. I saw what was behind it. Then my mind started to doubt it and said, that's not possible. Even though I intentionally practice it, even though I actually do know that it works and that others are able to do it as well. At this point, during my practice, I understood that the mind is really holding one back.
Is that your general conclusion? Is it the mind that hinders us in unfolding our abilities?
Yes, of course, yes.
This means that a certain worldview hinders the belief that would be necessary.
Correct. I think the social imprint is very important, and the personal belief of what's possible, because that will determine what is actually achievable. Nothing more and nothing less.
Considering all of your experiences with blind people and the personal experiences that you've had, where are the limits for us?
From my point of view, there are no limits. Limits are defined by people themselves. That depends on one's own previous experiences and one's willingness and flexibility. The more limits have been overcome, the more opportunities life will offer. In my opinion, everyone has the possibility to expand their consciousness and to stretch their limits out in order to achieve new goals, which are quite expandable regarding the physical and mental aspects.
Und die sind aus meiner Sicht sowohl im körperlichen als auch im geistigen Bereich extrem ausbaufähig.
Due to a power of vision that also can't be traced back to eyes alone, Georg Rieder from Austria became well known as the man with the X-ray vision, who is able to perceive illness and physical dysfunctions.
Dr. Fiala, this is a practitioner. What's made?
Dr. Fiala, a general practitioner, medical director, and forensic doctor, asked me what I actually see in the body. I replied, the bones, organs, and so forth. Well, an orthodox medical practitioner may be a little skeptical in that sense. Thus, he asked me what he needed to do in order for me to look at his bones. I said that he should stand around 3 to 4 meters away from me, and then I looked at him from the front and from the back. By doing so, I noticed that he has a hole in his right shoulder blade, which I told him. That was an almost devastating answer for him, because he didn't know what exactly had happened there. Basically, no one knew about it, since the hole in his shoulder blade was a result of being hit by shrapnel during World War II. Afterwards, Dr. Fiala invited me to his office, where I looked at five of his friends, who were also his patients, and, in some cases, I saw things that were not even known to Dr. Fiala himself. Regarding one of his friends, I noticed the kidney on the right side being twice as big. He had no findings, so he conducted a medical ultrasound scan, and suddenly I saw a duplex kidney on the right. This was one of many cases that had been consistently confirmed, which basically took away my own doubts, given I had also questioned it. I was in a pathology department once and saw a tumor in the brain of a patient who had passed away. They did an autopsy afterwards and looked inside the head, and it was there, just as I said it before, with a slight difference in color. That was effective proof for me that I am indeed able to look inside the person in front of me. Well, I do see things partially differently. Because to me, there is a difference whether a stomach ulcer happened due to irregular and unhealthy eating habits, or whether it happened because the person swallows sadness, worries, problems and stress. I do see a difference there. As a matter of fact, there are many differences I can sense.
Viele so Unterschiede, die ich halt irgendwo erkennen kann, ja? Weil zum Beispiel
bei For instance, I noticed in many people that as soon as someone had tonsil surgery, the thyroid began to change.
Also da gibt's einen Zusammenhang im Prinzip, ja?
Basically, there is a connection, which is not traceable in conventional medicine, though. A blind person playing pool and reading newspapers. Children wearing opaque masks and riding their bikes. A man who got known for his X-ray vision, which can even go through walls. Basically, there are two possibilities on how to handle these kinds of phenomena. They are either viewed as nonsense, as clever magic tricks and scams, or they're taken seriously. This would imply consequences for the materialistic worldview, though.
Do you believe, due to all of your experiences and possibilities they offer, that seeing without eyes proves that we are more than the physical, material body? What were the consequences for your worldview and concept of man?
Basically none. I already had this concept of humanity. I stopped maintaining the belief that we are nothing but matter a long time ago. If one begins to look around, to observe, and to take closer looks, especially on topics that you are dealing with, near-death experiences, then one will notice very quickly that our body is a vehicle for a certain period of time, which we are allowed to use. The body is a vehicle that contains the mind. It has to be like this, since even people who were clinically dead came back and explained that all of their senses were maintained and available. That was the proof for me, from the beginning, that we are much, much more than just the body. It was as if time stopped running, as if the time stood still. All of the fear that I had felt before, this whole fight, it all vanished in this very moment. It really was unbelievably calm. I was able to see everything what was happening there. And at the same time, I was in peace about it. Then I sensed this thought that I am not this body. The mind-blowing part was that I was still able to see, hear, and think while not being inside this body.
Things have come full circle. Apparently, that which is witnessed during near-death experiences belongs to a greater totality of phenomena of consciousness.
Do you see a connection between out-of-body experiences, which are common elements during near-death experiences, and the possibilities that are offered through seeing without eyes?
Definitely. There are three main theories which explain how seeing without eyes works. One of them is being issued in public. It's about the possibility that the brain itself perceives. Dr. Joe Dispenza published 2.5 pages in his book You Are the Placebo about a trainer who he did scans on while she was seeing without eyes, noticing that her visual cortex was processing information even though her eyes were closed. This proved our view on the subject because it means that seeing without eyes is a possibility that works through the brain. The second theory is that the subconscious mind takes over the visual function. There are researchers who speak for that as well. The third theory of ours is that the second body, or the spiritual aspect inside us, develops this ability and evolves it in its own consciousness. All three theories stand next to each other. For me, the theories are not as crucial. What's important to me is that it actually works.
What's important to me, the reason I'm here having this conversation, is to show people, here is someone who tried it and for whom it works. I'm not the only one, in my opinion. Why shouldn't it work for someone else, too? So, it's important to me to make people aware about one possibility which can make life even more worth living. For actual help in life, pragmatic standpoints are quite useful. Experiences like seeing without eyes raise important questions concerning one's worldview, though. Given that they originated from the spiritual or esoteric field, they may have been uninteresting for scientific research. Visual perception is assigned exclusively to physical processes with an obviousness, as if all coherences have already been explored. But what happens behind the eye? Who or what sees, perceives the world? What is consciousness? It may be the biggest mystery of our existence. How can an inner reality emerge out of a plexus in the brain? What are they made of, these images of our soul world, our hopes, dreams, all that which makes us qualitatively human? Nowadays, no one can answer these questions. The naturalistic philosophy, which dominates research and science, considers consciousness as a side aspect. But isn't such a worldview missing the most important basis, as long as the world's mystery, consciousness, remains unresolved? I wouldn't necessarily say that, because almost everyone has it and knows that one lives from and with it. What makes it challenging for us, though, is to unite that with what we know about the people around us, the brain or the capacities of the brain. But since we have it ourselves, it isn't neglected at all. It's just that we want to bring it all together, and that's something we've struggled with for hundreds and thousands of years. Many different approaches emerged from that, like the body-mind problem or the hard problem of consciousness. It's a persistent problem. Not because we lack solutions, but rather because there are too many answers, too many propositions. The naturalist goes with the identity concept, that is ultimately the same, but in different aspects, kind of from within and without. At first, one might think, well, but consciousness is so different from what we experience externally that one cannot unite it.
Dass man das gar nicht unter einen Hut bringen könne.
That is not the case. Something can present two different aspects. My favorite example is of a tin can which stands above a screen. From one direction, the can's shadow will appear round or elliptical. From another direction, it will be a rectangle or a parallelogram.
Ist dann kreisförmig oder ellipsenförmig. Und in der anderen Richtung ist es ein Rechteck oder ein Parallelogramm.
One might think that this cannot be the same, since it appears as a circle, smooth here, but as a rectangle or a parallelogram there. But if one knows about this additional dimension, or assumes it, then there is no problem anymore. Obviously, the body-mind problem, or the hard problem of consciousness, is much more difficult, because there are not just two projections which can be objectified, but rather many different kinds. But it is not an argument to say that these two aspects are simply too different, and that it is therefore impossible for them to be emerging from one and the same brain. The aspect of the inner world, with everything that belongs to being human, should, following the naturalistic worldview, at some point be explicable solely through the activity of the brain, even if there can be no talk of it at this time.
Die These ist also für alles, was wir fühlen, empfinden, hoffen, wonach wir uns sehnen.
So the thesis is that all the things we feel, sense, hope and long for are processes in the brain, and I think these processes are likely to be explained someday. But whether the interconnection of those two aspects will ever be explained, that I don't know myself yet. I probably won't experience it. It cannot be done as fast. The brain is the most complicated system that we know of, maybe the most complicated system in the entire universe. No wonder we have difficulties seeing through that. But we are making progress. The perception of the human being as a purely material manifestation also dominates technological development. Critical observers warn about the consequences for society.
Silicon Valley assumes that the human being is the ultimate machine and treats us accordingly, even views the form of society which we live in as in need of renovation. Democracy, for instance. We hear things from Silicon Valley like, democracy is an old technology, now we have to try something new. But the image of humanity, which we know from the Age of Enlightenment, or even before that, from Christianity, that the human being is the crown of creation, someone special, since he is able to act according to morals and knows the difference between good and bad. This image will get lost as soon as we turn humans into machines.
In science fiction, this future is self-evident. Human consciousness is being transferred to computers, machines awaken to life, and conscious artificial intelligence outstrips biological life. Reality, on the other hand, is sobering and less spectacular. As a matter of fact, we can't explain consciousness, let alone recreate it. Even the idea that it would originate from complex neural interconnections is controversial. How consciousness could emerge from matter remains speculation.
There are some scientists who assume that human consciousness evolved from a particular complexity of neural interconnections in the cerebrum. Therefore, some researchers conclude from that, if I make these neural networks big enough, consciousness will emerge as a side effect. I don't think so. But that is my personal opinion. I think one can neither positively nor negatively verify that. It is speculation in both cases. First of all, we have introspective access to some parts of ourselves, to our mental state. We have a consciousness of self. And we have access to our current needs and so forth. We assume that other people feel similar, but we see other human beings only from an external perspective. What that means is that we assign intentionality to other people, but we don't know it. We like to do it to our pets, maybe even to our cars or our computer. Of course, we are very much tempted to assign intentionality to a robot as well, especially if it resembles human looks. But these systems are zombies, so to speak. They are not conscious about what they do. They don't feel happiness if they win at Go, and so forth.
Some scientists are convinced that not the physical world, but rather consciousness, is the primary thing around which everything revolves. They view materialism as a dead end.
Well, I think what physicists do is they eventually, when they dig deeper and deeper into the nature of reality, they get to the point that they know they don't have the whole answer. They know there has to be something else. You know, that implicate order, that other thing has to be out there. Those hidden variables, that was an idea too. That there's there has to be something else going on to explain, because the materialist viewpoint just doesn't provide any answers. So they wave their hands in the air and they come up with something that, well, I think it's a cyclical thing, you know, and it comes and it goes on, you know, but try to pin them down to exactly how does that work? You know, what's the mechanism there and how that works? And they don't know. It's just an idea. So that, I think, is physics with its back against the wall, can't come to any conclusions because its belief in materialism puts it in a space that doesn't have the answer. So they're stuck.
Being stuck in certain perceptions about how the world works, what is possible. Maybe some phenomena, like seeing without eyes, will encourage questioning of old ideas all over again. Maybe we are witnessing indications here that consciousness not only acts from and in the material world, but that it can observe and lead externally in a way.
Nur das ist halt jetzt so, das was ich sehe, das sehe ich, ja, und
Well, it's like this, what I see, and this part of it is red, so everyone who sees this part will say, it's red, because my mother taught me that this is red. What I don't know is whether you see it as red, as I do. I've never looked through other eyes, basically. Conscious perception is very subjective and therefore very hard to grasp scientifically, to describe according to objective criteria. Intuition, sensation, hunch? We know that our perception is not limited to that which is conveyed to us by our sensory organs. Yet, this day-to-day experience-based knowledge eludes experimentation, the possibility to prove it or to capture it in numbers and data. Human consciousness. Does it extend beyond brain and body? It remains a fascinating mystery.